Hey everyone, it's Sarah. Welcome to Bits for Tea. Today I have my little August wrap-up, which is also the wrap-up for the Newts Readathon, the magical readathon hosted by G from Book Rose. You have probably all heard of it, but if you haven't, I will link all of the information down below. And I've participated in the magical readathon for the first time this year. I did the Olds in April, and now I just finished my Newts in August. And I am happy to say that I did it. I got my Hogwarts diploma to become a Hogwarts professor. I'm a professor in Muggle Studies, and I have my diploma right here, which says Sarah has been awarded the Diploma of Excellence in Magic by Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry. This certifies that they have passed at least 7 OWL exams in total, including Defense Against the Dark Arts and the subject they want to teach. They have further achieved the minimum of the following grades at Newt level: O in the subject they wish to teach, E in Defense Against the Dark Arts, and at least 2 A's in secondary subjects of their choice. This diploma is proof that they have mastered the skills needed to instruct in the magical arts and assume the possession of Hogwarts teacher. This certificate is valid internationally and is not limited to Hogwarts educational program. So yeah, I'm a Hogwarts professor now, and I'm very, very excited. And today I want to tell you all of the books that I have read for each of the different subjects and just let you know what I thought of these 7 books that I read last month. Okay, first up I had to get an O in Muggle Studies, and for the first prompt I had to read a book with an actual photo element on the cover. And I read Gracefully Grayson by Amy Polonsky in the German edition. And now this is already kind of a hard one to talk about because it's about a trans girl, Grayson, who is figuring out that she is trans and that she is a girl. And Grayson is, I think, only 12 years old, and it's kind of hard for her. And this follows her story as she gets cast as a female role in a school play and all of the trouble that comes along with that. And she tries to, you know, express her gender identity by putting on girls' clothes and stuff like that. And I thought that it was really sad because a lot of bad things happened to Grayson, but I also thought that it was like well written and really like a story that I thought could be representative of the trans experience. However, I can't speak for that representation myself, and the author isn't on Voices either. So I went onto Goodreads and looked up some more reviews, and it has a very, very good rating on Goodreads. However, some of the bad reviews are written by trans readers, and they have pointed out that there is some problematic things in this book. So they say that it's problematic because we see Grayson put on this role in the play, and we see her wearing girls' clothes, which is like the main identificator that she is a girl. And it's kind of like playing a role, like playing dress up, like suddenly you have girls' clothes on, and that's kind of all it is. And it doesn't really go deep into her gender. Doesn't really, you know, show us why she thinks that she's a girl. It's like, oh, she likes some girly things, she likes dresses, so she must be a girl, when in reality it's of course so much more than that. And it also says that it's really sad that only bad things happen to this trans main character. You know, she loses her parents when she is younger, she gets bullied at school, she experiences a lot of hate from her stepbrother and from everyone around her. Her favorite teacher is about to get fired because he cast her as a girl, and all of these bad things happen to her. And the review also pointed out that it's kind of bad to always only have those sad trans stories. Like, the only reason this book was written was for us to feel bad about this trans girl and kind of understand, oh, we should feel sorry, we should like let her be a girl because she is such a sorry person. I will link the Own Voices review down below, but some of those things that I just mentioned were points that the reviewer made and that, looking at the book now, I completely agree with. So Just enjoyment-wise, I would have rated this 4 stars, but I acknowledge that it is just because of my own ignorance. So after reading that review, which I think was 1 or 2 stars on Goodreads, I have currently lowered my rating to 3 stars, but maybe I should just like remove the rating completely because I don't really feel like I'm equipped to rate that kind of representation. But I would not recommend this book given the own biases reviews of trans reviewers. Okay, moving on to the next book, which was a lot better, and I read that for the prompt of a book set in the real world, and I read Red, White, and Royal Blue by Casey McQuinston. Now, you might argue that it's not technically set in the real world because we have a different president of the United States in this book. In this timeline in 2016, the first ever female president got elected in the US, and this is about her son dating the Prince of England, which the royalty in the book is also different from the actual royalty in the UK. But it's technically set in our world, it's set in our time, there's Twitter, social media, everything. It's basically just a contemporary romance, and it's so good. It's so cute. It's enemies to lovers, at least kind of. They weren't really enemies. The main character thinks, oh, I hate the other one so much, all of my thoughts are consumed by him, I can't stop thinking about him all of the time, he must be my worst enemy. Like, obviously they're in love, but it just takes a little bit to realize. And it's really, really good, it's really cute. I loved it a lot. I think there were some flaws with it. I wouldn't give it a full 5 stars. But in general, it was just really, really cute, and I listened to the audiobook of this, which I can really recommend because it's quite a thick book. It has over 400 pages, but the audiobook went by so fast and it was just so much fun to read. And I think the author is also non-binary, so that's really, really cool to support. And yeah, I really, really loved the romance. It was adorable, sometimes a little bit too over the top cutesy and romantic for me personally, like a little bit too cheesy, that's the word I'm looking for. But in general, it was just very wholesome, very cute, and they kind of just caused this huge international scandal by dating, and it's very, very lovely and adorable, and I gave it 4, maybe 4.5 out of 5 stars. Then finally, to complete my Muggle studies, I had to read a book written by a person of color, and for this I picked Binti by Nnedi Okorafor, and I read the first little novella in the Binti series, which is not a whole book, it's like 75 pages, and it was only okay for me. It's a sci-fi novella about this girl Binti, who is Himba, which is this like tribe of people that usually just stay within their own community and they never go out and like explore the world or anything. But Binti is really, really smart, and she has been accepted into this international university and decided to go against her family's wishes. She basically runs away from home and goes on a spaceship to go to this university. However, the spaceship gets attacked, and there are these aliens that kind of keep her captive, I guess. And I'm not gonna say much more because, as I said, it's only 75 pages, so not much happens. It's just not that great of a sci-fi novel for me. I really enjoyed the cultural representation. We definitely see Binti as this like African woman who is really connected to her people, and I really, really like that. It was culturally very diverse and something different, but the story itself and the sci-fi element wasn't really for me. I thought that maybe it was just too short, but there was a lot of tell and no show, so we would hear that Binti has made these great friends, but we would never see like any interaction between them, so we couldn't get attached to them or their friendship. And then there was this big conflict, and to me it just got resolved way too easily and like without any real like drama or interesting plot. So I ended up giving this 2.5 stars and will not be continuing with this novella series. Moving on to Defense Against the Dark Arts, where I had to get an exceeded expectations. And the first book I had to read was a book that's Black Under the Dust Jacket. And for that, I read On the Comma by Angie Thomas, which is completely black. And I really enjoyed it. It's about this girl called Brie, who is a rapper. She always gets in trouble at school, where she is one of the only black kids, and realizes that like the teachers and the security and everyone are kind of targeting black kids and Latinx kids way more, and they get punished for things that their white classmates would never get punished for. And she is just angry a lot of the time, and she is also a great rapper. Her dad used to be a rapper before he died, and she has a lot of talent. So she goes to this place where different rappers battle and have like freestyle rap battles, and she goes there and immediately the crowd loves her. She's so talented, and she starts making her own music, and there's a lot of conflict around staying true to yourself and, you know, the media making you into someone that you're not. And I just really, really like the way that these themes were discussed in the book. This is also set in Garden Heights, so in the same neighborhood that The Hate U Give was set in. And I knew that, and I knew that some of the characters from The Hate U Give would be referenced again in this book, but I didn't know how much the events of The Hate U Give affected this story. But I really, really liked it. And it was just such a good story. It really shows us what this 16-year-old girl is trying to do, to, you know, support her family, become famous, chase the dream of being a rapper, and how much trouble and how much hardship she faces, how she has to deal with racism and stereotypes just because she's black. And once again, Angie Thomas has just written a really, really important and good novel about what it's like to be black in America in our time. I'm neither black nor American, but I can just tell that this is really, really good representation, and that so many kids out there are seeing themselves in this book, and I can wholeheartedly recommend it. I personally like The Hate U Give a little bit more, and thought that maybe instead of having this be 450 pages, it could have been a little bit shortened at times. But in general, I really, really loved it and ended up giving it 4 out of 5 stars. Then I had to read the book that first came to mind when I watched the TBR video, and that was, for me, Dress Codes for Small Towns by Courtney Stevens. Now, I read this mainly because Books and Lala keeps talking about it. It's one of her favorite books. So I was very, very excited, and I ended up enjoying it, but I didn't love it as much as I would have hoped. It's about Billy, who is this kind of tomboy girl who doesn't really fit in with her really, really small town community. Her dad is a priest, and she keeps getting into trouble, and she and her friends always are up to really, really stupid ideas. And it's about life in this really, really small town, where like the greatest thing that happens is this big harvest festival. However, the founder of the event dies, and now the city doesn't know where to get the money for it to keep having this event every year. So Billy and her best friends start a little fundraiser and think about what they can do to save the Harvest Festival. And it's a lot about Billy and her sexuality and her love for all of her friends, which is, she at one point says that she loves all of them very dearly and doesn't really know how to deal with all of that. You know, she doesn't know what is romantic love and what is just platonic, and she's just overwhelmed by emotions. And she is bisexual and figures that out during the book, and it's just a really, really good book in all of those aspects, and I really enjoyed it for it. It was very diverse when it came to sexuality, because all of these characters are kind of trying to figure out where they are in the spectrum, and it's about how falling in love can really change your friendships with people, and how to deal with that when your friendships are so, so important to you. And I thought that it was a good book. However, the writing was what didn't have me enjoy this as much as I could have, because I found it very, very difficult to read and to concentrate and to understand what's going on. There's like no info dumping, which I mean is good, but you're just always thrown in. You are not really introduced to any of the characters. You just read about them and then you're supposed to know, oh yeah, that's that character in this like huge friend group. And sometimes it was just a little bit hard for me. I don't know, it was probably completely my fault, but I found it a little bit hard to sometimes follow what's happening and to really know who all of the characters are. And I understand why people love it. One thing that I really liked was that Billy is actually religious and never like has any doubts in her mind about believing in God, but she still, you know, doesn't see any kind of problem with her sexuality, with the sexuality of her friends. And I just really, really liked that. I thought it was very good representation for, you know, Christian girls who aren't like perfect or super like devoted all of the time, but they just have faith and they pray occasionally, and I really like that. And overall, I gave this book 4 stars. I would recommend that you read it if the themes are friendship and coming of age, sexuality stories intrigue you. You should read this book, but for me it was just a little bit hard to read, and it sometimes put me out of the story a little bit. I changed my TBR up a little bit and used one book for another prompt. And for Herbology, the prompt was to listen to an audiobook. And for this, I ended up picking Pan's Labyrinth by Cornelia Funke and Julie Mero del Toro. And I listened to this on audiobook. I first picked it for a beautiful cover because it's absolutely gorgeous. But yeah, I ended up reading it for the Herbology prompt. And this is a fantasy story. Like, the whole book is based on the movie Pan's Labyrinth, which I still need to watch. But I used to think that it was like a children's story, and it's definitely not. It's like really horror, gory, spooky, scary. And I did not expect that. And I think from the way it looks and the way that it's marketed, a lot of young kids are picking this up, like maybe when you're like 12 or something, and I think that it's very, very brutal and should probably, I don't know, I mean, I read Hunger Games when I was that age, but I feel like this shouldn't really be read at that young of an age. And I think that the marketing was kind of bad with this book because it's really, really horror and brutal and gory at times. But basically it tells the story of Ophelia, who is a young girl, and her mother has just married again after the death of her father, and she's married this really, really horrible commander who is basically a human monster, and he's trying to kill everyone who is part of the rebellion against the horrible government in the Spanish Civil War at the beginning of the 20th century. So this deals with a lot more than I thought, but it's also a magical story about Ophelia, who basically gets lured in by this faun who tells her that she is a princess and she needs to come home to her father, who really, really misses her. Sorry, I'm losing my voice. So she goes into this labyrinth, and there's magic, there's quests, there's spooky, scary stuff, as I said. I liked it, but I think I just expected something different, which is why I only ended up giving it 3 stars. I found it dragged at times and could be shortened, but I liked the poetic writing. I liked that we had like little stories in between that like told different like myths that were eventually all kind of connected, and they were kind of like little fairy tales from that world, and I liked that. But overall, something was missing for me to really, really love that book, and I ended up giving it 3.5 stars. Now finally, we have probably my favorite book that I've read, and that was for Charms, which was to read a book with a beautiful cover. And I read Heartstopper by Alice Oseman. Now everyone on BookTube has been raving about it, which is why I picked it up, and it's so cute. It's a little webcomic about those two boys who fall in love and are just super cute, and it's like, it's a graphic novel. You can read this in like half an hour, But it's so pretty, it's so nicely illustrated. The boys are so pure. I like the side characters, I like them. I actually recently found out that those are actually side characters that play a very minor role in Solitaire by Alice Oseman, and now I desperately want to read this. I've only ever read Radio Silence and enjoyed it, so now I want to read everything that Alice Oseman has written. I want the second book in this graphic novel series as soon as I can get my hands on it, and I just am really, really, really in love with Nick and Charlie. They are so cute, and I ended up giving this 4.5 or 5 out of 5 stars because it just made me so happy and a little bit emotional, and it's just the kind of queer romance that everyone needs. Okay, that's it for this video. Those are all of the books that I read in order to become a Hogwarts professor. Let me know if you have read any of these books, if you've participated in a magical readathon, and if you've achieved any careers. If you have any wrap-up videos for that or vlogs, leave them down below in the comments because I would love to watch them. Other than that, tell me what your favorite book was that you read last month, and I will hopefully see you all in another video very soon. Thanks so much for watching, and goodbye!